Good morning, children. Then let's start the same lesson, Deep Water by William Douglas. First, let's talk about which we have already read in the previous classes. So we have seen that when the narrator was pushed into water, then, first of all, while going down, he had made a plan that as soon as his legs would touch the water, touch the bottom of the water, then with all his strength, he would try to jump up. And as soon as he would come upon the surface of the water, he would lie flat. And then he would paddle, and this way he could get the edge of the pool. So this plan he made when first time he was going down the water, when first time his journey towards the bottom had started. First time anyway carrying out his plan, his eyes and nose came upon the surface of water, but his mouth was still under water. He was striking the water. He was fighting with the water. He tried anyway. His legs would come up, but all his efforts were in vain. He was fighting with the water in the same way as anybody fights with an irresistible force in his nightmare. He could do nothing. He felt as if some unknown force was pulling him down, dragging him down, and then his second journey towards the bottom of the water had also started. And his second journey towards the bottom of water was more difficult than first. Why? Because in his second journey, he was tired. His legs became paralyzed, became powerless, as if they had gone numb. He had lost all his breath. He wanted to cry, but as if his cries were also frozen. His whole body had become stiff, rigid. But in spite of all these difficulties, in spite of losing almost all the parts of his, in spite of losing the strength of almost all the parts of his body, still he had not lost one thing, and that was his sense, that was his reason. Still he was remembering his plan, his strategy that was made by him first time going down the water. What was the plan? His plan was that as soon as his legs would touch the bottom of the water, with his full strength, he would try to jump upwards, and while coming upon the surface of the water, he would lie flat, and then he would move his legs and hands, and anyway he could save himself. So this plan, this strategy, still he remembered in spite of all the difficulties. And finally his toes touched the bottom of water, and then with his full strength he tried to spring up, he tried to jump up. Now let's see. But the jump made no difference. He jumped up with his full force, but the jump was useless, meaningless. It couldn't help him to come upon the surface of water. The water was still around me. Still he was surrounded by water. I looked for ropes, ladders, water wings, nothing but water. It seemed as if his hands were trying to look for ropes. If somebody could give him ladders, if somebody could give him water wings, but no, nothing was there except water. Wherever he tried to catch anything, clutch anything, only water came in his hand. A mass of yellow water held me, a mass of yellow water, a collection of, a heap of yellow, dirty water had caught him. A stark terror took an even deeper hold on me, like a great charge of electricity. A stark terror. Stark means complete. His terror was not an ordinary terror, not a simple terror. It was complete terror, intense terror, violent terror. Here there is comparison between the terror which had caught him and the charge of electricity, as if somebody has electric shock in the same way he was caught by the terror. I shook and trembled with fright. He was trembling with fright. He was shivering with fright. My arms wouldn't move. My legs wouldn't move. I tried to call for help, to call for mother. Nothing happened. Neither his legs were working, nor his hands were working. He was trying to cry for help, but nobody could listen to him. In fact, he was trying to call his mother for help, but his voice was frozen like his body. It was not going out of the water. And then, strangely, there was light. I was coming out of the awful yellow water. At least my eyes were, my nose was almost out too. And then, to his great surprise, to his great astonishment, he saw some yellow light, glowing light. That light was outside light, light of the pool. Why? Because anyway, as he had tried to jump, so his eyes and nose had come out of water, and that's why he could see the yellow light of the pool, outside light. Then I started down a third time, but alas, again he started going down. This was his third journey towards the bottom of the water. First time when he was pushed by the bruiser. Second time when anyway with his jump his nose and eyes were almost out of water and he was striking the water, he was beating the water, he was fighting with the water so that his legs would also come up, but it did not happen. Some unknown force pulled him down. So that was his second journey towards water. And now again his nose and eyes were out of water, but his third journey towards the bottom of the water started again. Means that was the third time that he was going down the water. I sucked for air and got water. I sucked for air. Suck means here, inhale. He inhaled air. He breathed in air. But what did he get? He got only water. The yellowish light was going out. The yellow light of outside. The outside yellow light, the outside glowing light, shining light, was now slowly, slowly disappearing. Why? Because he was going down the water. Because his nose and eyes were again under the water. Then all efforts ceased. I relaxed. Then suddenly he felt as if no efforts were left in him. No energy was left in him. He felt as if his body had become loose. Even my legs felt limp. His legs became lifeless, paralyzed, senseless, numb. And a blackness swept over my brain. And the brain, which was working, even in his second journey, his brain was working. That's why he had not forgotten his strategy, his plan. But now, in his third journey, his brain also became totally blank, quite blank, quite dark. Means his brain also stopped working, stopped thinking. It wiped out fear, it wiped out terror. There was no more panic. If suppose your brain has stopped working, then there will be no room for any kind of emotion in your brain. There will be no place for any kind of feelings in your brain. Either it was a feeling of fear or it was a feeling of happiness. So now he had no fear. All his fear, panic, terror had vanished, had gone away. Children, fear, panic, terror, all the three words are very close to each other. All have almost the same meaning, but little difference. Fear. Fear is a strong, uncontrollable emotion caused by a real danger. And terror, this is also fear, but sudden and intense fear, violent fear. Then panic, this is also violent fear, but it happens, it affects a group of people, a group of animals. So this is little difference among all the three words. Here the author has used all the three words. Why? To emphasize that there was no fear at all in his mind, as now he was going to be unconscious. This is nice to be drowsy, to go to sleep, no need to jump, too tired to jump. It's nice to be carried gently. He was feeling drowsy, he was feeling sleepy, and he felt in the state of his semi-consciousness that it was nice. Why? Because in his sleepiness, now he didn't need to jump. He didn't need to make any efforts. So to be swept away with the water, to be carried away with the water without making any effort himself, without any using any force, with water he was being carried away, and his tired body liked this. It was nice to his tired body. Tender arms around me, tender arms like mother's. Now I must go to sleep. He felt as if someone's soft arms were around him. In fact, his mother's arms were around him, and his mother's arms were trying to make him sleep. I must go to sleep. So in the state of his semi-consciousness, he told himself that he must sleep. I crashed to oblivion and the curtain of life fell. Truly speaking, he was in the state of forgetfulness. He had forgotten everything after that what happened to him. Oblivion means forgetfulness. Oblivious, forgetful. And the curtain of life fell. Almost he was dead. Not dead completely, almost he was dead. The next I remember, I was lying on my stomach beside the pool vomiting. When his eyes opened, then he found that he was lying beside the pool and vomiting. The chap that threw me in was saying, but I was only fooling. The chap, the boy, the man, 18 years old boy, the bruiser, who had thrown him into the water, who had pushed him into the water, he was telling, I was only joking. I was only fooling. Fool, noun and verb both. When fool now, then a foolish man. Fool walk, then be fool. He told that he was simply be fooling. He was simply joking. Someone said, the kid nearly died. We are right now. Then he heard that some other boy was telling that the kid had almost died. But now he is all right. Let's carry him to the locker room. That person told that he should be carried to the locker room. What is locker room? A room with lockers which are generally used, especially used for changing clothes, for keeping clothes, for a sportsman. So, the other person told that the boy should be carried to the locker room now. Several hours later, I walked home. After several hours, anyway, he came back to his home. I was weak and trembling. I shook and cried when I lay on my bed. Although now he was out of water, but the fear had gripped him so violently, so terribly, that when he lay on his bed, he was shaking. He was trembling. I couldn't eat that night. That night, he couldn't take his meal. For days, a haunting fear was in my heart. For days, for several days, the haunting fear means the fear which strikes you again and again, which comes to you again and again, which repeatedly attacks you. Such kind of fear had seized him for so many days. The slightest exertion upset me, making me wobbly in the knees and sick to my stomach. The slightest exertion, even the little walk, even he walked for some time, then he felt as if he was too much tired, as if his legs were trembling, shaking, and he felt like vomiting. I never went back to the pool. I feared water. I avoided it whenever I could. And after that, after this incident, he never went to that pool, the pool of YMCA. And whenever it was possible, he avoided water. So children, now some questions. So my first question is, what is the misadventure that William Douglas speaks about? The misadventure that William Douglas speaks about is his drowning into the pool at the YMCA. What were the series of emotions and fears that Douglas expended when he was thrown into the pool? When he was into the pool, he had not only one emotion, he had a series of emotions. First of all, when first time his journey had started for the bottom of the water, then he was afraid, but he had made a plan. His plan was that the moment his legs would touch the bottom of the water, he would jump up. But as he had planned, it was not so easy. The way was too long. Although the depth was hardly 9 feet, but it seemed to him 90 feet. And he had thought that he would jump up like a cock, but he was coming up very slowly, slowly, slowly. When second time his journey started towards the bottom of water, Then his legs, his all the parts of body had lost power. He had lost his breath. Almost he had lost his breath. Even his cries seemed to be frozen. Only his head and heart were beating. He felt as if he had such an attack of terror as somebody has shock of electric. He felt that he was seized by such terror which had no understanding. And in his third journey, he felt as if he had lost all his strength and he was going to be unconscious. Now question number three, how did this experience affect him? This experience affected him badly. For several days, even after little work, he felt upset. He felt like vomiting. He felt as if his knees were shaking. And the fear which he had experienced was haunting him. He never went to that pool again. And whenever it was possible, he tried to avoid water. So that's all. Thanks.